When you're trying to get pregnant, being able to identify what your fertile window is one of the most important things that you can do, because we know that that timing is so important. So there are a couple different ways that you're able to do that, both predictive ways that we'll talk about that help identify when you're getting ready to ovulate, and also a couple confirmatory changes that you can see afterwards that will help confirm that you ovulated as well. Sperm can live in the female reproductive tract for 3 to 5 days. It does just fine there. It lives in the cervical mucus, it can even be in the fallopian tube itself, but the egg can only be fertilized for 24 hours after it's ovulated. So it's really all about knowing when that ovulation takes place and really kind of trying to have sperm in the reproductive tract at the time that that egg is released to give it the maximum opportunity to be able to meet and fertilize and make an embryo. The first half of the menstrual cycle is pretty much your brain talking to your ovary and trying to get a follicle or an egg to form to be released. Your brain is communicating with your ovary by sending out this follicle stimulating hormone message. And that's getting those follicles going and growing. As they start to get bigger, they're going to be making estrogen. That estrogen goes up and it serves to tell your brain, we've got one that's forming. You can go ahead and cool it on the follicle stimulating hormone. You've done a great job, but we only want one egg to form. The follicle stimulating hormone signal shuts down, and then as that egg grows to a certain point, the luteinizing hormone is released from the brain, and that's just kind of the final trigger that says that egg is ready, go ahead and release it. The spot from where that follicle releases and that egg releases becomes this new kind of cool functioning organ. It's called a corpus luteum cyst. And it works by making one of the really important hormones, progesterone. And progesterone is kind of the key hormone for that second 2 weeks of the menstrual cycle. And that's really what helps sustain that lining of the uterus and allows the embryo time to make its way through the fallopian tube and into the uterus to hopefully achieve a pregnancy that month. The corpus luteum lasts for exactly 2 weeks. Once that 2 week timer goes off, it shuts down shop, the progesterone level goes down, and unless there's a pregnancy that's implanted and kind of starting to make its own pregnancy hormone to sustain that uterine lining, you get a period. It all sheds and you start over again. So an ovulation predictor kit, the idea is that, like we talked a little bit about with the menstrual cycle, so for those first 2 weeks of the menstrual cycle, your brain is trying to grow a follicle on your ovary and get it to become a mature egg that's able to be released and fertilized. So what the LH predictor kits do is they look for that luteinizing hormone. And they specifically look for it in your urine. So it's kind of similar to a pregnancy test. The idea is that you just kind of like pee on the little stick or you dip your urine, dip it in your urine, and it picks up on that luteinizing hormone. And as soon as it gets above a certain threshold, which we see with the surge, it's going to become positive. And the best thing about that is predictive of ovulating. So that's going to happen before you ovulate, which really allows you to better time that timed intercourse and get sperm in the reproductive tract so it's there waiting for that egg once it's released. So if you have a really regular cycle, say you have a textbook 28-day menstrual cycle and you start bleeding every single month on like day 28 or 29 of your cycle, then we kind of think backwards. So we know that, again, those two parts of your menstrual cycle, the egg growing phase and then the kind of wait and see whether you're pregnant phase after ovulation, the second part of the menstrual cycle is always 2 weeks long. So if you have a 4 week cycle, you can count back a little bit and say, well, if I have a 28-day cycle, then I'm probably ovulating right around day 14. And that ovulation predictor kit, that LH surge, happens about 36 hours before you ovulate. So that LH surge is probably gonna happen around day 12 or so. So we usually have people start testing around maybe day 9 or 10, just to make sure they don't miss it in case it comes a little bit early. And then you're using it probably about once a day, just to see when that becomes a positive. There are some people who every single time they use an LH predictor kit, no matter where they are in their cycle, it's gonna be positive. And there are some people who every single time in their cycle, regardless of whether they're ovulating or not, it's gonna be negative. There are some people it just doesn't work for. And that has to do with their own kind of hormone balances. And somebody who isn't getting any cycles is getting very irregular cycles. It can be really frustrating because we don't know when to tell you to start trying. So if you have a really irregular cycle, it's probably just best to seek out the help of a fertility specialist. One other good change that can sometimes be predictive is changes to cervical mucus. During those first 2 weeks, as that egg is growing on the ovary and getting ready to ovulate, it's gonna be making more and more estrogen. So estrogen has a lot of effects throughout the body. It's gonna grow your uterine lining to get it ready to receive an embryo, but it's also gonna make changes to your cervical mucus as well. So cervical mucus is going to change throughout the course of everybody's cycle, and everybody's a little bit different. But when that estrogen level is really high, it turns into a little bit more of that stretchy mucus that you hear people talk about. And that's, again, a result of that estrogen. So as that estrogen level is peaking, that means you're getting ready to ovulate. So when you notice that change, that's a really good time. If you're kind of looking to time your intercourse, it's a good time to get on it. Another way that sometimes people try to confirm ovulation or show that they have ovulated is by doing something called basal body temperature monitoring. We know that progesterone is going to cause a slight increase in basal body temperature. So when that egg ovulates and that corpus luteum becomes functional and is starting to make progesterone, sometimes we can see a shift in some people in terms of what their baseline temperature is. The tricky thing about this is, one, is very labor intensive, if you've ever tried it. It involves a lot of tracking and logging of these temperatures at the same time every day. And the change in temperature we see is very, very small. So you have to use a good thermometer and be very careful to do it at the same time every day. But it's not predictive of ovulation, which is the tricky thing. It confirms ovulation because you already have that rise in progesterone if your basal body temperature has changed. And at that point, the egg can no longer be fertilized. By the time you see that change, we've already kind of missed the boat for that month. There are a couple different reasons why people can not ovulate regularly. You can have too many eggs inside the ovary. So you can have something like PCOS. When that happens, you essentially have so many follicles inside your ovary. This is like a very non-scientific way of describing it, but how I think about it, you can have so many eggs inside your ovary that they essentially can't work out amongst themselves which one is gonna grow and get ready to ovulate. So it kind of just turns into this traffic jam and nothing gets done. So you have a whole bunch of follicles in your ovary, but none of them are ovulating. And typically with that, we'll see irregular cycles, or sometimes people with PCOS just don't get periods at all. You can have too few eggs in your ovary, and that's why you don't ovulate. And then there is sometimes just the hormonal signaling that takes place between the brain and the ovary is a little bit out of whack. So you can have perfectly normal ovaries, but the signaling that tells them to recruit one follicle to grow and release is sometimes just a little bit jumbled up. And sometimes we can see that in people who have thyroid levels that are too high or too low, prolactin levels that are too high, and some other hormones too can kind of wreak havoc with that really kind of specific communication system between the brain and ovary. So typically what we say is when you're trying to get pregnant, if you have regular cycles, I think that you can use some of these really good tips, use these ovulation predictor kits, and try to time that fertile window. If you have irregular cycles and it's really hard for you to figure out what that fertile window is, then it's always better to come sooner rather than later. We'll be able to identify exactly what the issue is with kind of a pretty simple workup, and there are pretty straightforward options that we have available just to try to get you to ovulate and give you the same chances as somebody else who is having those regular cycles. We can do that with something as simple as an oral medication. If there are any other hormonal imbalances, we're able to identify them and kind of get them straightened out, and then sometimes the problem kind of fixes itself.